One more time, let's put our hands together and appreciate that Cross Symphony Orchestra. Wonderful experience in music And tonight, the stage is set for that very special experience we've all been waiting for. Church, over the past 30 years, the International Central Gospel Church has built a reputation for excellence and integrity in every field of endeavor. God has been good to this church, and the notable interventions can be found in the area of education with the establishment of the nation's premier private university. Other interventions can be found in the area of healthcare, social services, and transformation of the lives of people in the different assemblies that are scattered across the world. But tonight, the greatest gift of the International Central Gospel Church is the gift of leadership. We are where we are because God has been gracious to us to give us a leader who stands out among the nations of this world. Tonight, with joy in our hearts, with appreciation, we want to welcome to Open Destiny Summit 2013 our General Overseer and Conference Host, Dr. Mensah Otabil. Let's show some appreciation.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Please be seated in God's presence. And it's a joy to have you this evening at the beginning of our Destiny Summit. We had a session in the morning for our leaders, and it was just a wonderful time. Dr. Sam Chand was with us this morning, and the leaders who were here. How many of you were here this morning? What a great service we had, and two great sessions. And we just want to encourage all the leaders who are not in, please get the CDs and the DVDs of those morning sessions. He will be speaking tomorrow night. That is Dr. Sam Chan. We were properly introduced to him last year. And he was such a blessing to us, and he's here again. Welcome, sir. You are most welcome. And we have one of our regular speakers also with us, a very dear friend of mine that I've known for many, many years. He's been speaking at Destiny for so long, and he's here, Pastor Ransford Obing from Kumasi. And Pastor Randy Morrison is arriving tonight. But to open our session today, we have somebody that we know. Dr. Mike Murdock is in the house. And sir, we are honored to have you in our church, in our conference this time, and to receive you. Dr. Murdock is a Christian philosopher. He's a man of wisdom. Philosophy simply means lover of wisdom. He's a man of wisdom. I think for all of us preachers, at some point in our lives, everybody has quoted Mike Murdock. He is probably the most quotable preacher or speaker anywhere on this planet. When you listen to Dr. Murdock speak, almost every sentence is a quote. So you have to write every sentence and keep writing every sentence and writing every sentence. And he allows us to go and re-quote him. So we appreciate the offer to re-quote you wherever we go. And for those of you who preach, who are preachers, just one line of quote can give you a sermon. So I'm sure tonight some of you preachers are going to have about six different series delivered to you from this one subject that Pastor Murdock will be ministering. But he has distinguished himself over the years in so many areas, in music, a prolific songwriter and minister. He's a prolific author, written several books. He has become a model for so many people, many Christians, who have patterned and modeled their lives and their ministries after him. He speaks all over the world, in some of the major conferences of the world, very treasured gift to the body of Christ. Many years ago, he was here, but that was probably more than 10 years ago. He came to speak for Pastor Matthew Oshimolo, and they used our premises here. But today, we are the ones bringing him ourselves. And we are honored that he was able to make it and to come and speak for us for these number of days. We are honored to have you, sir, and our hearts are open to your ministry, and we believe that God will deposit something tremendous and significant into our lives because of what you carry. So it's my greatest honor and privilege to welcome a general in the body of Christ, God's servant, Dr. Mike Murdock.
You may be seated. Hold your Bible close to your heart and stroke your Bible like you would stroke the cheek of a child. Now kiss your Bible. Kiss it again. Now rub your Bible over your face. The gospel has two parts: the person of Jesus and the principles that he taught. The person of Jesus creates my peace. The principles of God create my prosperity. The person of Jesus prepares me for eternity. The principles of Jesus prepare me for the earth. I can be ready for heaven and can't succeed on the earth because his principles create my prosperity. Kiss your Bible again. I love sitting at your feet. I love hearing what you say. I love knowing all your desires. I'm so pleasured to obey. Your favor is like a sunrise, driving all my nights away. I love sitting at your feet every single day. I love sitting at your feet every single day. The only thing God does in the Bible is talk. God loves words so much he called himself the Word. Everything divine starts in the mouth. God loved words so much he called himself the Word. When he wanted a nation, he creates. Wants a world, he spoke. The mouth is the birthplace of destiny. Everything in your future starts inside your mouth. Something you say schedules experiences in your life. I can trace every loss in my life to something I said. Conversation is the birthplace for everything right and everything wrong. My mouth can kill, my mouth can begin. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. stroke your Bible again. A lady came to me and she said, do you have a word from God for me? I said, 800,000. Now kiss your Bible again. If you don't have a Bible, we'll sell you one after service. Rub your Bible again over your face. There are seven reactions that reveal the character of a man. His reaction to authority, the only person authorized to promote you. Your reaction to a gift determines if you get a second one. Your reaction to correction reveals your humility. I judge a man by his reaction to this word. Kiss your Bible again. Kiss it again. Takes 56 hours to read the Bible through. 56 hours. His word is pregnant with strength. Daniel said he spoke and I was strengthened. I asked the Holy Spirit one day, what's the most important thing that I could do for somebody? You're like me. This is why we're here. We have a real passion to help people. We hate pain. We want everybody to succeed. So you're probably like me. You're constantly looking for a problem you can solve. Because everywhere there's a problem, there's a future. Until somebody has a problem, you're unnecessary. It's the problem that decides your worth. It's a problem that decides your salary. Until you can see a problem, you can't see your future. A problem is a door to the future. Until there's a problem, there is no destiny. That's the whole purpose of creativity, is to solve a problem. Everything created solves a problem. The microphone solves a problem. My watch solves a problem. I was cultivated by God to be a problem solver. And the problem I solve determines my prosperity, my favor, the honor. Listen carefully to this, because this is so powerful when you grasp this. And I asked the Holy Spirit, what's the most important thing that I could do for another human? Give them some food, buy them clothes, let them sleep at my house. What's the most important thing I could do for somebody? The most important thing you can do for a human is inspire faith in the Word of God. If I can get your son to believe this book is from God, is the Word of God, if I can convince your son, your daughter, I have solved every problem in their life. I have solved their depression. Jesus said, I spoke these words that my joy might remain in you and be full. If I teach your children to have confidence in the Bible, I have protected them in every adversarial environment they enter. Thou, through thy commandments, has made me wiser than my enemies. You don't want God to remove an enemy, because then you lose your reward system. Revelation says the only people that God blesses are overcomers. So if God removes your enemy, you don't get the reward. You got to kill Goliath to get to the throne. So you don't want God to remove your enemies. You want the Word to make you wiser than your enemies. Kiss your Bible again. Tell somebody next to you, someday you'll love this Bible as much as I do. Just look at them and say, someday you'll love this Bible as much as I do. If I can get you to have confidence in the Bible, You'll never be weak a day in your life. Because Daniel said, when God speaks, I get strong. If I can get you to have faith in the Word of God, you will never live an hour without divine favor. Because the only thing God craves is to be trusted. Out of these 800,000 words, 1,189 chapters, which is the most important scripture? Obviously, Numbers 23:19. God is not a man. God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. He has spoken it, he will perform it. God has one obsession, one ecstasy, and that's the obsession to be believed. He has such a passion to be believed that he gave us a factory for faith. He said, faith, confidence in God. Faith comes, so does doubt. Faith comes by something you hear. Faith comes by something you hear. Faith comes by hearing this word. So when the words of God enter me, confidence in God rises. His words produce confidence in him. If you say, Brother Mike, I don't have much faith, I would say, oh, you just need to get his words. His words will create your faith. You don't sit there and struggle to believe. You just start speaking his words. Faith comes when I hear something God would say. Faith comes when God talks. Jeremiah 1, he said, I'm putting my words inside your mouth, Jeremiah. So God's words come to our mouth so we can put it in somebody's heart. Faith comes. And everything in your future will be created by your faith or your doubts. How many want a future created by faith? Wave a hand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to learn this little love song to the Holy Spirit. I love sitting at your feet. I love hearing what you say. Try it. I love hearing what you say. I love knowing your desires. I love knowing your desires. I'm so pleasured to obey. I'm so pleasured to obey. Your favor is like a sunrise. Your favor is like sunrise. Driving all my nights away. Everybody, all my nights away. I love sitting. I love sitting at your feet every single day. I can hardly hear you. Maybe it's just me. Try it again. I love sitting. Do you sing? I can't hear you. Every single day. Look at someone next to you and say, what's wrong with you? Why don't you sing? I love sitting at your feet. Everybody, I love hearing what you say. I love knowing your desires. I love knowing your desires. I'm so pleasured. I'm so pleasured to obey. 1994, the greatest day of my life, July the 13th. It was a Wednesday morning, 7 o'clock. And that was the day that I fell in love with the person of the Holy Spirit, the one who stayed, the one Jesus trusted so much he was willing to go through Calvary, knowing the Holy Spirit would raise him from the dead on the third day. He said, come into his presence singing. That's why we sing. A song is the corridor into the Holy Spirit world. You sing your way into his presence. He fired the choir director that I call Lucy. Some people call him Lucifer. But he fired the choir director, and you and I get to sing to him. Don't you love singing to him? Oh, hell. Nobody like you. There is nobody. There's nobody like you. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet Holy Spirit, there's nobody like you. When I'm in your presence, I always change. I'm just not the same. I'm just not the same. When I'm in your presence, Holy Spirit, I change. And I can't go back. I can't go back to yesterday again. I'm in love, I'm in love, I'm in love. I'm in love, I'm in love, I'm in love. Sweet Holy Spirit, I'm in love. I'm in love, I'm in love, I'm in love. I'm in love, I'm in love, I'm in love. Sweet Holy Spirit, I'm in love. Teach me how to please you. Show me how to pleasure you today. Let me live in your presence that comes every time I obey. Dominate my mind with your word. Dominate my mind with your word. Oh, dominate my mind with your holy word. Dominate my mind with your word. Dominate my home with your word. Oh, dominate my home with your word. Oh, dominate my home with your holy word. Dominate my home with your word. Someday you will believe someone Someday you will believe someone, and that day will decide what you become for the rest of your life. Who have you decided to believe? We don't live the way we're taught. We live by who we believe. I wish I could tell you that if you had a great father, you would succeed, but that's not true. Absalom and Solomon had the same daddy, and one was a fool. I wish I could tell you that if you had a great mentor, you would succeed, but that's not true. John and Judas had the same mentor. Every word you've ever heard will grow like a seed over time. And the word that you believe will either set you free or forever enslave your mind. Tomorrow has been decided, your future and what will be. You created all your tomorrows when you decided who you would believe. Someday, oh, I love these words, you will believe someone. Someday you will believe someone, and that day will decide what you become for the rest of your life. Who have you decided to believe? Hold your Bible high in the air and say, I believe. Oh, say it loud, I believe.
I believe.
I cannot change your life till I change the voice you trust. I cannot change your life until I change the voice you trust. It's not what you hear, it's who you believe. Every word you've ever heard will grow like a seed over time. And the words that you believe will either set you free or forever enslave your mind. Tomorrow has been decided, your future and what will be. You created your tomorrows when you decided who you would believe. Look at someone next to you and say, I'm very concerned about your ignorance. Oh, come on, look them right in the eye. You've been wanting to say that to them for years. This is now your opportunity. Just say, I'm concerned about your ignorance. Your world will change if you know that every problem in your life is because of your ignorance. God said that. God never warned us a whole lot about the devil. There's very little said about the devil because he's not your problem. Ignorance is your problem. My people are destroyed for lack of. My people are destroyed for lack of. So ignorance is a deadly enemy. It really is. And I'm always doing something stupid. Somebody asked me, said, how can I pray for you? I said, pray that my stupidity will leave. Pray that my stupidity will leave. The only proof of learning is regret. If you have a day without regrets, you didn't learn anything that day. Because every time you learn something, you should say, oh, I wish I'd have did it differently yesterday. So regret is the fragrance of progress. When you say, oh, I wish I would have learned that. I was asking Dr. Chan some things tonight on the way, because as you know, he's greatly used of the Lord with leaders. And I said, what's the problems we preachers commonly make? I want to know where we make our biggest mistakes. I consider myself a professional learner. I'm not quite a professional yet, but I'm getting skilled. I consider myself to be a learner. That's what I do for a living. A lady asked me one day in the airplane, said, what do you do, sir? I said, I'm a learner. She said, I mean, what do you do for a living? I said, that's what I do. I'm a learner. I would never spend more money on clothes than I would in my mind. My mind's my Garden of Eden. I kill the snakes, pull the weeds, grow the flowers. My mind is where I succeed or fail. If I can manage my mind for a day, I can manage my life. God didn't ask me to change his world. He asked me to manage my mind. There's only one way to manage your mind. Your mind needs a conversation. Your mind needs conversation. That's why God gave you a mouth to conquer your mind. Your mind is not you. It's the servant God gave you. My mind needs a hero, someone to inspire me. Because if you can stay inspired, there's nothing you can't do. Nothing. One inspired terrorist can do more than 10,000 uninspired Christians. I was born in America, where 9 men rule the world through that domain. We have 300 plus million Americans, 150 million Christians. They took Bible out of the schools. Nine men took Bible out of the schools, took prayer out of the schools. Nine men inspired to destroy Christianity has done more than 150 million Christians. Inspiration is a force. Don't tell me righteousness always wins. The first righteous man was killed by the first ungodly man. Cain killed Abel. Look at somebody next to you and say, if you stay stupid, we can't be friends. Go ahead, look them right in the eye and say, if you stay stupid, I can't be your friend. We have any children anywhere? Just a child. I want to use a little illustration here. We have a child anywhere. I want to do a little illustration. Let me say here. You want to come right up here, son? I've got 500 and I've got 10. I'm going to give you your choice, okay? Which one you want? He chose the 10. This is a lot bigger number. Wouldn't you rather have 500? You sure? This is Nigerian money. I don't have any money from here. That's a $10 bill. Don't you like 500 bigger? And it's bigger, isn't it? You still want that? Why? But 500 is bigger. Pastor, you might want to teach him. You count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, but you stopped at 10. What is wisdom? Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference. Thanks. You have both. I don't know what you can do with a 500, but okay. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference. Difference in money. I remember when I got my first offering in Nigeria, I just was so ecstatic. I got home that night, pastor in the hotel, and they had given me a big offering. And man, this money, just a pile of money. $1,500. I couldn't believe it. I've never been so blessed in my life. Man, just a few of these, I'll be a millionaire. And then they told me what it was worth. Now, you may already know this, but I didn't. That thousand is about $7 in United States money. Huh? I was stunned. Boy, my joy. So all of this money is about $150. I was going to write a new book on how God made me a millionaire through Nigerian money. It's all wisdom is. Proverbs 4:7 says, wisdom is the principal thing on the earth. Wisdom is the principal thing on the earth. It's more important than anything in our life. So what is wisdom? The ability to recognize difference. Difference in people. Difference in people. Difference in a moment. That's why the blind man cried out, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy. He knew there was, they said, shut up. He said, Bible said he cried the louder. He knew the difference in that moment. Difference in an environment. Even God doesn't do well in places. That's why Jesus left Nazareth, went to Capernaum. He could not do many miracles in that environment. Difference in an environment. Difference in an opportunity. The thief hanging next to Jesus said, would you remember me today? You don't have to be real smart to make heaven. One sentence and his past was forgiven. Would you remember today you'll be with me in paradise? One sentence, and he made eternity with God. Difference in a moment. Difference in countenance. When Joseph saw the countenance of the butler and the baker, he saw a problem on their face. Remember, your reactions reveal your character. His reaction to a problem, he said, what's wrong? What can I do? Everywhere there's a problem, there's an invitation for honor. Everywhere you show honor, you create favor. Everywhere there's favor, there's money. I'll prove that and share that in a few moments because money is not a miracle. I never pray for money. Why? Money's not a miracle. Money's a reaction. Money's not a mystery. Prayer's not the seed for money. You've seen pictures of rich men. Do they look like prayer people? Donald Trump is one of our richest in America. He don't look like an intercessor to me. Joseph reacts to the difference in his countenance. You have a problem. What can I do? In every conversation, I listen for four sounds. I need the sound of pain, because if there's pain, I'm invited to remove it. I listen for information. I listen for a question, which is the most powerful thing on the earth, because your success happens at the speed of your questions. God doesn't create seasons. Questions schedule your seasons. I listen for the sound of honor because I can't help anyone who doesn't trust me. And since I'm an investor, investment of my energy, investment of my mind, investment of my time, investment of my money. I consider myself to be an investor, and I invest because God looks for a return on everything he deposited in me. God's my number one investor of my life, so he wants a return. So I listen for the sound of honor. Joseph looked at him and said, you've got a problem. What can I do to solve it? Wisdom is the ability to see difference, to recognize a difference, difference in people. I read somewhere where everybody's born equal. What stupid statements is that? And nobody's born equal. We're not equal in looks. We're not equal in IQ. We're not equal in any way. Even God made that statement. Even Jesus knew that. That's why he gave one man one talent, another man he gave five, another man he gave two. None of us are equal. If everybody's equal, who are you going to learn from? Again, look at somebody and say, I'm concerned about you. Difference in opportunity. The purpose of wisdom is to identify who you should honor, because success is determined by the seed of honor. Honor is different than wisdom. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference. Honor is the willingness to reward someone for their difference. Our bishop is known all over the world. You already know that. He's a man who's respected. His integrity is known. He's loved. He's believed because of his life. There's a difference. The first time I ever saw him, ever, first time I ever saw him, I believe, was on television. And he was at a conference. And I stopped everything I was doing because I sensed a difference in his anointing. There was a difference. The purpose of wisdom is to identify who is worthy of honor. Jesus had seven circles of relationships. Every one of them required a different vocabulary. You don't talk to your child the way you talk to your wife. The Ten Commandments are about one subject, honor. The first four commandments deal with honoring God. The last six deal with honoring people. Your future is determined by who you honor. What was the difference between Absalom and Solomon? Solomon knew who to honor. You can have five children. I'm one of nine children. My mother had nine. Seven of us lived. I've got four sisters, two brothers. And the child who honors you is your wisest child. Not your oldest child, the one who honors you. If I know who you honor, I know your wisdom. You reveal your wisdom by who you've chosen to honor. I was in a board meeting one time, and I watched a man talk to the pastor like he was his equal. Well, I tell you, this is what I think. This is, I know you say God told you this, but this is what I believe. Now, God doesn't kill all liars, does he? We're here. But Ananias and Sapphira didn't know who to honor. That's all the tithe is. The tithe isn't to pay for the robes of the angels. God doesn't hope we pay tithe Sunday morning so he can pay for the gold. God doesn't say, please pay tithe because the angels are eating so much. No. The tithe is an invitation to document your honor. That's all the tithe is. It's 10, 1 out of 10. The word tithe means 10th. There's only one reason people don't pay tithe. One and one only. They don't really believe what God said about the tithe. They don't really believe it'll multiply. They really don't believe God will do what he said. The highest proof of dishonor is a non-tither. So the purpose of wisdom is to know who I should honor. Honor is not a feeling. Honor is something, is substance. Proverbs 3 said honor is substance, something you do for somebody. Honor isn't bowing. I was involved in the martial arts many years ago where you bow and then you stab them. So bowing is not proof of honor. It's a symbol, but it's not proof of honor. What is wisdom? The ability to recognize difference. What's the purpose of wisdom? To identify who you should honor. A lady came up to me in America and said, Dr. Mike, I treat everybody the same. I said, what? She said, I treat everybody the same. Oh, so what nights a week do you go to bed with your neighbor's husband? Is it three nights a week? You cook breakfast for your neighbor's husband? Put your hand on your head and say, I refuse to be stupid. I'm the offspring of God, and I'm a receiver of wisdom. I want to talk to you about something the Lord stirred me today in the hotel room for you. And I think it's going to make a major difference. In fact, I know it'll make a major difference in your life. There's so many things we're going to cover this week, and I'm excited about it. We're going to talk about the value of an enemy, because the enemy has a different reward than a friend. A friend gives you comfort. An enemy gives you a reward system. An enemy can give you in a day what your family can't give you in a lifetime. Goliath gave David more in one day than all his brothers gave him in their whole life. So an enemy has a different purpose. We're going to talk about recognizing that in a moment. You can live with a lie for a lifetime. And the only time you recognize a lie is when your belief system cannot produce something you want. I was preaching for Benny Hinn in a meeting in Dallas, in the arena there, 22,000 people. And while he was preaching, and I was there that weekend speaking for him, a man went on television to hurt Benny Hinn. He's a pastor of a great church, about 18,000 people in his church. He speaks Greek and Hebrew. He speaks Greek and Hebrew. This man's a smart man, and he's a Christian. Now, just because you're Christian doesn't mean that you're smart. They're stupid Christians. Just like a lawyer. A lady told me, she said, my son's smart. You know, he's a lawyer. I said, that don't mean he's smart. Half of them lose. This man says, Jesus doesn't heal anymore. This is a man who knows Greek and Hebrew. This is a man with 18,000 people in his church. And he says to people, Jesus doesn't heal. Then he says, have you ever heard about the prayer language? And everybody, yes. He said, it's from the devil. And I sit there and look at this man. How could man love God to be this stupid? I hope heaven's big so he don't have to be close to me. Because if you got a stupid friend, you don't need a devil. That stupid friend will take care of things. I sat there, how could this man know Greek and Hebrew and be so stupid as to believe that Jesus doesn't heal? But you only know what you've been taught. You only trust someone you believe in. I thought about that. It may be years before. He may have to get cancer before he believes that Jesus heals. Because we always consider people important relative to our needs. How could a man know God and not know that? But you only know what you've been taught. My father is a man of prayer. He'll be 97 years old in about 6-8 weeks. He'll be 97, has never spent one night in a hospital. Lives next door to me. He's a man of prayer, prays 4 to 10 hours a day. I've never heard a wrong word out of his lips, never heard a wrong word from my father. He's the holiest man I've ever been around in my lifetime. Obsessed with pleasing God, obsessed with obeying the voice of God. To this day, will not have a television in his home, does not believe, he won't even watch me on television. But he's a holy man, he's a righteous man, he's a good man. But when I wanted to go to Bible school, cost $4 a day. $4 a day, and he didn't have the money to put me in Bible school. That messed up my head for a couple of years. If you love God so much, why don't he give you any money? If God's so great, why don't you have any money? And it took me years to realize that prosperity was produced by laws. That God doesn't decide who has money. That obedience to a law creates prosperity. And I was teaching one day on a school because I have a real interest in prosperity. I feel like money is a tool. The purpose of money is to create experiences for people. That's the purpose of money. Jesus spoke more about money than he did prayer and faith combined. There's 500 scriptures on faith. There's 500 scriptures on prayer, but there's over 1,000 on money. A man came up to me and said, "Don't you think that Jesus, Jesus was poor?" I said, "What fool taught you that?" Jesus said these words, "The poor you have with you always, but not me." Out of the 12, one man did nothing but carry around a bag of money. That's all he did. A prostitute took 2 years of her income and bought perfume and poured it on Jesus' feet and then rubbed his feet down with her hair and dried it. And the disciples said, this could have been given to the poor. So if Jesus was poor, it was happening. Again, look at somebody next to you and say, "There's several of us concerned about your ignorance." Just look at them. Say, "Several of us are concerned about your ignorance." When my father heard me teach on this, he walked up to me, and he doesn't brag on anybody. My dad's never said 5 wonderful words about any child. He's just real quiet like that. But he walked up and he said, "Son, if somebody would have taught your mother and I what God has taught you about prosperity, my whole ministry would have been different. But nobody taught us that." You only know what you've been taught. You're only experiencing the part of the Bible you believe. I even had one man, pastor, come up to me and he says, "I can believe the Bible, except I just can't believe all this money blessing stuff. I can't believe that part of the Bible on prosperity." I said, "Brother, if you've just got to doubt a chapter in the Bible, don't doubt the money part. Doubt the hell chapter. But don't doubt the blessing part." Say, "I believe." Say it again, "I believe."
"I believe."
Say it loud.
"I believe."
I heard a preacher say, we were talking, Dr. Sam and I told him what my thoughts were. I was in a conference and a preacher said something very loud. I'd even written a song about it. I've written 6,000 songs. The last 1,000's been to the Holy Spirit because I fell in love with him. He's the only person you have to obey your whole lifetime. Don't that take a lot of stress away? And a preacher says, "God's in control." And everybody jumped up and shouted and ran around. And so in the little green room after the service, I walked up to him with a pen and I said, "I want you to write down the things God controls." He said, "Everything, everything, Mike, everything." I said, you sure? You sure? "Yes." Says, "So write them down. Write down everything." He said, "Everything. Everything that happens on earth was predestined by God." How many has ever heard that philosophy? Several of you. I said, "So if your little daughter gets raped tomorrow night by a man, you're at peace with that. You're okay. Because God was in control. God was in control. You okay? Your little boy, if your little boy gets killed in a car accident, your wife is driving, and a drunk driver smashes into the car, While you're standing there at the funeral, you're at peace. God was in control. Are you going to be one of those that said God needed some flowers in heaven? I heard one preacher say that. God took this little child because he needed some flowers in heaven. Boy, don't heaven now excite you to see dead children stuck everywhere in the soil? Good, stupid. That's really why I want to go to heaven. I'm not afraid of the fire in hell. I'm afraid of being with all the idiots of the earth in one place. He looked at me and says, I hadn't thought about that. And I laughed. I said, well, if you'll think twice, you'll be the genius in your family. If God has predestined your life, how does he reward you for obedience? If everything that happens was God was in control of everything in your life, why did he say 331 times, if, Isaiah 1:19, if you're willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. Isaiah 1:17, he said, learn to do well. Learn. My success doesn't depend on my prayer life, though I'm a great believer in intercession every single day in the secret place. But it depends on my obedience to a law of God. Psalms 112, a man that loves the law of God, wealth and riches would be in his house. So if I don't have any wealth, I ask, which laws have I broken? A lady came to me and she said, Dr. Mike, I'm 3 months behind in my house note. I said, which preacher did you defy? She said, what do you mean? I said, the Bible says if you believe a prophet, you'll prosper. You're not prospering, so there must be a prophet you hadn't believed. Who was he? What part of the Bible have you refused to believe? We're going to cover many things this week. Don't you miss a single session. Small keys open bank vaults. I felt stirred to talk to you about the art of receiving. Never in my lifetime have I heard anyone talk about receiving. Heard a lot about giving, hadn't heard much about receiving. And the whole Bible is about receiving. Well, Brother Mike, you have to give before you receive. How could you do that? How could you give if you hadn't received anything? How many has heard you have to give before you receive? How many realize now you have to have something before you can give? So receiving comes first. But we haven't been taught to receive. The entire Bible is a book about receiving. For God so loved that he gave. God's looking for receivers. God's obsessed to find receivers. Pastor, there's a little girl at the Wisdom Center. I've known her since she's 15 months old. She just turned 16. She's never brought me any pain. I've known her since she was 15 months old. She is the most skilled receiver I've ever known. See, the way you receive is your gift to a giver. A quality receiver brings great joy to a giver. She likes pink. So I bought her a pink TV, pink iPad, pink luggage, just pink. She loves pink. Here's how she responds, no matter what I give her. How did you know? This is just what I've been wanting. I had supper with her and several members of the family the other night. And I suddenly remember it was school time, so I reached inside my pocket. Every time you find good soil, get excited. Every time you find good soil, get excited. Sowing's not enough. There's a lot of seed doesn't produce a harvest. Seed's impotent. Seed has no power. It has to get into a covenant with soil. You can lay seed in your cabinets and be there 20 years, it'll still be seed. No harvest. Got to be a covenant. I said, oh, I know you need some clothes, don't you? And I pulled out some money to give to her, and she went, I got four sisters. Can I talk to you ladies like you're my sister? Can I do that? Every man's looking for a receiver. And it's the way you react to his first gift that determines if he schedules a second gift for you. You understand? If I can get you skilled at receiving, I've solved your problems. Are you a skilled receiver? What do you mean, Brother Mike? John 1:11 says he came into his own. His own received him not. Whatever you don't have is something you hadn't received. Whatever's missing in your life is something you've been incompetent at receiving. Because God's a giver. He's looking for somebody to receive. God gives a lot of gifts that are never received. We entered the earth as receivers. We came out of our mother's womb, and the family was there. Maybe the doctor was there. And we received affection. We received attention. We received caring. They brought us food. We entered the world as a receiver. Somewhere along the line, we don't know how to receive. I gave a young lady a car. She hadn't had a car. Had several children walk into the Wisdom Center. I heard that, so I bought her a car. She said, look what God gave me. I said, how long you been serving God? She said, 15 years. I said, he ever give you a car? No, he didn't give you a car. I gave you a car. Grasp that. Don't bypass the divine channel for receiving. We don't receive because we don't recognize who God has used to bless us. Think on this a long time. Whatever you don't have is something you didn't know how to receive. There's five things you should learn how to receive. Number one, receive your parents as a divine gift to you. Receive your parents as a divine gift. The first key to money is how you treat your parents. The key to money is how you treat your parents. The key to money is how to receive your parents. If I honor my mother and father, thanks, Pastor. it will go well with me all my life. God said that. If you come up here tonight and say, Brother Mike, I don't have money. I don't know what's wrong. I'm going to say, when did you talk to your mother last? What have you done for your father? My reaction to my parents determines how God reacts to my money. There's 1,000 tithe checks can't substitute for honoring the authority God put over you. You see, the first decision God ever made over your life was who your mom and dad would be. One of my staff said, Brother Mike, that's not true. My mother was raped by a man, and I'm the child of rape. I said, that was God. What do you mean, God? God raped? No, that you were born. God saw the thorn and said, I'll leave a rose to overcome this bad experience. I said, you are the way your mother will recover. She said, you mean God used a rapist? I said, something in him combined with something in your mother brought out a true, true woman. Honor your mother and father that your days will be long on the earth. I can hear you talk to your dad, your mama. Now, girls know how to talk to dads. I don't know about Ghana, but in America, girls really work their father. Love you, daddy. Love you, daddy's girl. If a woman treated her mother as good as she treats her dad, it may be here. But a woman in America really works her dad. You've got daughters, right? I love you, daddy.
Every day.
Daddy, you look good, daddy. Every you look day. Good. Hi, mama. Daddy, you look good. My sisters, four of them, could get more out of my daddy in 5 minutes than I could get in a month. I'm talking about true honor. Have you received your parents as a divine decision? Have you protected them? I buy my father's cars. I bought his houses. I've given him a check on the first of every month for years and years. Why? He is my father. He is my father. When he was 80, I took him to Jerusalem, and he's stroking a briefcase, and I know he likes it. I said, Daddy, you already have 15 briefcases. He said, but I don't have one like this. You think I'm going to let him leave without a briefcase? He gets anything he wants. How do you treat your mother and father? Have you received them as divine gifts? Have you received them? A man tweeted me on Twitter this week, says, what's the best way to show honor? I said, obedience. Obedience. When we bought the Wisdom Center, I took my father. Now, I've been paid by one corporation for 1 hour more than my father's church paid him for 20 years combined. But he's my father. I don't make major decisions without my father. I said, Daddy, this Wisdom Center, 135,000 feet, very nice. What are your thoughts? Why? He's my father. He's my father. If he's my father, it means he has a say-so in my world. He's going through Alzheimer's. And sometimes he wakes up in the middle of the night and looks at my sister and says, and what is your name, little lady? And it just kills her and she cries. But he's our father. He is our father. Wherever there's been disrespect. I had a relative who I love very much, but made a statement that because he was my relative, he ought to be able to talk to me, thanks, any way he wanted to. So I made a video. I said, I may just be old Mike to you, because we've known each other a whole life, but I'm still a man of God. And let me tell you what happened to the last guy who looked at Moses and said, you shouldn't marry a woman of a different race. Leprosy came all over him. Then his sister, Moses' sister Miriam, didn't like the woman he married. Leprosy came on her. It didn't bother Moses, but it bothered God. And not until Moses prayed did their leprosy disappear. Why? How do you talk to a man or woman of God? What is your reaction to a man? Well, Mike, he's my brother-in-law. He's a preacher. Said, I've known his whole life. You know, he's not. No. If God has chosen that man to put an anointing and a grace upon him. I walked out of a court when I was 33 years old. And I'd been done wrong by the judge. And I shook my head. And I told my staff, I said, you couldn't pay me to be in that man's shoes. He had a car accident, went into a wheelchair, and died within 6 months. You can't raise your hand against a man of God. You just can't do it. You can't do it. I want to say to every preacher's child that's here, your father may have been so obsessed with the ministry that you feel like he neglected you. But don't forget, he's not just your daddy. He's a voice that God's put on the earth. Don't play with that. Don't play with that. If your father's a pastor, you better go back, repent for every single pain you brought to his life. Do you know how to receive authority? Do you know how to receive authority? I was going through the customs. Now, I've been all over the world. In Canada, the customs are full of devils, those men. They are full of devils. I mean, sometimes you just want to lay hands on them. But I just don't have the faith the devils will leave. I just don't. Oh, they're horrible. I've been to Russia. Russia treats you like almost Manila. But Canada, they hold machine guns on you. And when they pull your books out of the suitcase and your picture's on the book, how do I know this is you? You ever been to Canada? Same guys? Shh. Horrible, aren't they? And then they start the feelers, they're fondlers. They're looking for a gun. Call them professional molesters. And so one young man traveling with me wanted to get smart aleck. I said, oh, son, you're not the authority here. Well, they do you wrong. I said, I know, just bow your head. Just be humble. You ain't the law here. How do you receive? Now, in America, I don't know, I hadn't seen the TV here, but America, sometimes when a man is on the run from police driving through the city, we have newspapers that are in helicopters. And they fly over that man and they report all of us. And you'll turn on the TV and there's a man driving. He's driving. And the newspapermen sit, and the police are all behind him following him. They say, he's been this 55 miles, he's gone now. He's been driving this way for 45 minutes. And we're all watching this man running from the police. And he always hits a telephone post. So he hits a telephone post, and he always falls out on the ground, whoever it is. And he starts running from all these police. These police have guns. They're running behind him. What a man. What a man. This is the kind of man every woman should marry. A man so full of hope. A man that believes he can outrun 3,000 bullets. This is a Superman. And he's running. And you're sitting there, are you stupid? Then he falls down and the police come up. They don't want to shoot him. They got to get some kicking in. Because he never learned how to receive authority. Who taught you how to receive authority? Who taught you how to receive someone with... I felt so honored tonight. When Pastor got through talking about me, I couldn't wait to see what I was going to say. I said, I'm excited about this. Because I do love the wisdom of God. I need it so bad. Have you received the difference in someone else? Because difference is the key to success. You married your wife because of her difference. You come to this church because of its difference. You go to a restaurant because of its difference. If I say Muhammad Ali, you say boxing. If I say Michael Jordan, you say basketball. If I say Billy Graham, you say evangelism. Do you know your difference? Can you tell me your difference in a word? Can you tell me your difference from everybody around you in one word? If you can't, you don't know your difference. Which means nobody is searching for your difference. Money's in your difference. Your prosperity's in your difference. How do you receive an opportunity? I called my office years ago, said to the young lady at the desk, I said, her name was Kim. I said, Kim, Dr. Murdock here. I said, honey, I said, I really need some help with my mail tonight. I'm just so backlogged. Could you stay overtime a couple of hours? And she said, oh, Dr. Murdock, I'm dating a new boy tonight, and I've never dated him before, and I'm really wanting to be with him. I said, I understand. I called three people, totally three. None of them said they had time to work overtime for 2 hours. What nobody knew is that I have a lot of things given to me, and I had a car someone given to me I didn't need. And I decided whoever worked overtime that night, I was going to give them that car. I didn't tell them, of course, just let them see if they had a servant's heart. They didn't, so I didn't give the car away. My secretary called me one day and said, Brother Mike, said, the couple that normally brings you to the airport, they want to go shopping all day tomorrow. Could you drive yourself to the airport? I said, oh, I could drive all of you to the airport. There was a young lady, had four children. Three of them were triplets, all of them teenagers. She was always coming up to me and says, if you ever need me, let me know. I'm here for you, whatever you need. I called and I said, Alice, this is Dr. Murdock. I said, Alice, I need someone to bring me to the airport tomorrow. It would be an honor. So she started bringing me to the airport. One day somebody gave me $200, said, do anything you want to with it. So when I got off the plane, I said, Alice, somebody gave me two $100 bills, and they said that I could do anything I wanted. So go buy your children some school supplies. Oh, thank you, Dr. Murdock, thank you. One night I was coming in at 5:30 in the morning from California. I said, Alice, you've got four children. You got to get off to school. So I'm going to take a taxi to my house. Oh, a man of God in a taxi? I said, oh, there's nothing wrong with a taxi. I said, you just take care of your children. No, oh, no, Dr. Murdock. Oh, no. I'll have somebody help me, but I will be there. She was there, Pastor, with a chauffeur's uniform she bought for herself. 5:30 in the morning. She received an opportunity to serve me with thankfulness, gratitude. Somebody gave me $500. So I got off the plane one day and I said, somebody gave me $500. Here's $500. Go buy you some clothes. Every woman likes clothes. Then one day her car broke down. I said, Alice, what kind of car have you always wished you had? See, the most exciting thing to a giver is to find a qualified receiver. I bought her the car she wanted. She knew how to receive an opportunity. You want to come up here a second? You want to come up here? You want to come up here? It's a little illustration. Three of you line up. You can face the people. Let's just say I have three assistants. You can sit down here. And I said to this brother, I'm sitting here with him. Whew, I wish I had some carrot juice. And he says, I like carrot juice too. You like carrot juice? Yeah, I like carrot juice. Okay. This one hears me say that and he says, well, Dr. Mike, if I had some carrots, I'd make you some carrot juice. This one says, he likes carrot juice. I'll be right back, Pastor. He comes back with the carrot juice. Would you like it twice a day? Do you want an apple in it? How would you like it? Now, get ready to get in on my jet. Which one of these do I want to be with me? I know all of you are going to choose this guy, huh? Because he likes carrot juice, too. We're both in agreement. We like carrot juice. Oh, we like carrot juice. You think I'm going to bring him? Rocky here. I know if you had some carrots, you'd make me some. So do I want to bring him? Because he can make it if I bring him some. Or do I want this man who heard my desire and he brought me some carrot juice? Do I have to pray over these three men? Oh, God, which one should I bring with me on this trip? Oh, I'm going to fast 3 days over these three men. To him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Withhold not good from them and to whom is due, whence in the power of your hand to do it. Isaiah 58, Ephesians 6:8. What I make happen for others, God will make happen for me. One out of the three received an opportunity to remove my discomfort. Received an opportunity. Now, I don't really know these men well, so all three of them maybe would have got me some carrot juice. But I'm using for illustration. You're not mad at me, are you? You're not mad at me. Okay. Don't you feel extra tonight? Okay. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Give them a hand clap. How do you receive? How do you receive an opportunity? I'm at Dallas-Fort Worth Airport, and there's a woman in a wheelchair outside. All the taxis lined up, fixing to get in the van, and she was just sitting there in the wheelchair. Nobody was talking to her, nothing. I teach my people, always look for problems. We're anointed to solve problems. We're anointed to solve. That's what we do. That's what we do. We remove pain. We're anointed for that. I said, ma'am, I said, you okay? She said, uh-huh. I said, you got a ride? She said, no, my daddy's dying. And I flew here, and I don't have any money left on my ticket for a taxi. Did I pray over? No, because God doesn't write checks. God ever wrote you a check? Me neither. God wrote you a check, you'd sell it on eBay or something. I pulled out a $100 bill and said, taxi. Here they came, all of them. I said, don't give this to them until you get to where you're going. I looked at a man, she needs to go to Plano. It's another town up the road. I want you to take her there, and when you get there, she'll pay you. Why? She had a problem. Everywhere there's a problem, there's opportunity for honor. I don't reap where I sow, I reap what I sow. I received an opportunity. Everywhere in your life that there's something missing, there's something you didn't know how to receive. Do you know how to receive the difference in a woman? Men, a woman is not a man with long hair. A lot of men don't know that. A woman is nothing like a man. Nothing. Nothing. She was God's greatest gift. God said to Adam, Adam, I want you to receive a garden. Then a few weeks later, he said, Adam, I want you to receive a zoo. And Adam woke up with a giraffe licking his face and squirrels running across his legs. And God said, he needs something I'm not. He needs something I can't give him. And he woke up, and there was Eve. God said, he said, well, what is this? God said, you can name her like you name the animals. And Adam said, whoa, man. She was God's highest level of gift. God's greatest gift to a man. Can you receive her difference from you? Each one of your children are different. Can you receive their difference? What have you rejected? Have you rejected your own assignment that God has given to you? Until you master the art of receiving, how do you receive instructions? If you have to tell your secretary something twice, you need to have her salary. Say the word church.
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 I want him to teach me how to talk. When you was up here tonight, say it real loud again, church.
Church. Church.
Learn fast from that illustration. How do you react to an instruction? Does your boss have to say something five times to you? How do you respond? How do you receive? What is it you haven't received? Two things, and I want to pray something over your life. I was in a hotel, and a man shouted my name. Dr. Mike, went over to him. man and look at your company. God uses me like this. Give you some thoughts. He said, no, no, I've had the best of the best. I paid $500,000 to people to come look at our company, and it's bankrupt. We can't do a thing. I said, brother, I'm free. I'm free. I got a jet and two pilots. He said, what would you charge me? I said, I don't charge. You can be a salesman or a sower. I'm a sower. He said, you would do that for me? I said, sure. So I flew there, spent a couple of hours. The business took off. Everywhere there's a problem, it's an invitation to show honor. Everywhere there's honor, there's favor. I've never done anything like this in my life. And he gave me his $28,000 Rolex. 2 weeks later, he said, a lot of passion, I could tell. A lot of passion. Let me give you one more opportunity. One, two, three. What is it you're not receiving? What is it you're not receiving? Something arrived that you didn't accept. We think of the Pharisees not receiving Jesus. What has God given to you that you didn't receive? If I could teach you how to receive, every problem would be solved in your life. Every problem. Every problem. At 4:30, I was sitting in a chair on a Wednesday afternoon some years ago, and God gave me an instruction about sowing seeds. Now, anybody that knows the Bible knows that everything we have is a seed. My words are the seeds for feelings. My time is a seed for understanding. Learning is the seed for knowledge. Knowledge is the seed for changes. I'm a walking seed factory. Every time I sow a seed, wrapped with expectation, God spoke to me. Something I had never done before. In 72 hours, heaven had broken through on my life. God will never ask you for something you don't have. But he'll always ask you for something you want to keep. God bless me, including the financial area. Money in every part I had invested in my life. I had more money than I had church projects. I had money that I didn't know what to do with. That's quite a place. Whoever tells you money won't make you happy hasn't had any. Had enough money to buy a beautiful jet, cash. Then another jet that cost three times what that one did. Bought three jets, cash. never ask one single penny from a single partner. Not $1 from a human on the earth has been given to buy me jets. God, give me three. Because of one instruction he gave me, and I received that instruction. I received it. How do you receive an instruction? How do you receive an instruction? How do you receive an opportunity? I was in Brazil, and I was telling 5,000 pastors about, there's been 8 levels of seed sowing where God has greatly blessed my life. Greatly, incredibly. And I told them, I was preaching for Rod Parsley, and I had $8,500. And God said, how would you like to explore what I could do with your $8,500? Who? $8,500. I just said back to the Holy Spirit, that's okay. I appreciate the $8,500. And the Lord came back again. He said, how would you like to explore what I could do with your $8,500? Then I thought, my dreams are bigger than $8,500. And what God did for me was beyond belief. So I told the people, about 5,000 pastors. And I looked at the pastor, I says, if there's anybody, God gave me a lifetime idea. God gave me an idea that went into Walmart and all the big stores in the world. And every time they sold, I got a royalty. God blessed me for a lifetime. And I said, if you want God to give you a lifetime blessing like he did me, bring a seed of $8,500 to the platform and just let me pray that what God did for me, he'll do for you. Because the anointing I respect is the anointing that grows in me. A man named Pastor Silas Malafaia. Have you been to Brazil, Pastor? It's worth going. Good people. Pastor Silas Malafaia from Rio de Janeiro walks up crying with an $8,500. I don't know what do you call the money here?
Huh? CDs.
CDs? Like disc? Really? CDs. CDs. How you spell it?
C-E-D-I-S.
Huh. I learned something tonight. I learned something. So he comes up with $8,500. How much is that in CDs? CDs. $17,000. So it's like 2-to-1 kind of? Ah, okay. I learned two things tonight. He walks up to the platform, and he's holding his $8,500, 17,000 CDs. CDs? Just like that? CDs? Am I saying it right? I'm not. CDs. Okay. I told you I needed wisdom. I need wisdom. And he's holding up his $8,500. I lay hands on him. He falls flat on his back. And God says, tell him that everything I do for him, I'm going to do. Everything I do for you, I'm going to do for him. Tell him I'm going to give him a jet too, cash. So I leaned down beside of him. He was crying, shaking. God not only gave him a beautiful Gulf Stream, holds 19 passengers. He's flown me all over Brazil. The bathroom is so beautiful that I could sleep in his bathroom for an apartment. Gold, Rocky, gold. One day he flew me all the way back to my house in Texas. From Rio de Janeiro, two pilots flew me all the way back. Pastor Ron, I think you were with me, weren't you, on that trip? All the way back, flew me in that plane. I said, brother, you can't do that. He said, you taught me two things. You taught me honor, and you taught me how to sow my seed. Today, his stadiums run 300,000 in his meetings. He's the Billy Graham of Brazil. It's astounding what God has done with his life. The anointing you respect is the anointing that grows in your life. We have a wonderful man of God in America called Bishop T.D. Jakes. I don't know if he's ever been to Ghana. Has he ever been to Ghana? He has. Do you know Bishop Jakes? Yes. And so he's planted thousands of dollars in my ministry. But I was preaching for him one night at Potter's House in Dallas. And something, that grace comes upon me. And I turn, I said, Bishop, has anybody ever given you $1 million? He shook his head and said, no. All of his board members sitting there, no. I said, they will after I pray for you. I said, money follows me everywhere I go. I don't understand it, just does. But I'm going to lay hands upon you and ask the Holy Spirit to send somebody to give you. Has anybody ever given your church $1 million? Has it happened lately? Ready for it again? Do you know what to do with it if somebody comes up and gives it to you? You know what to do. Okay. Get ready. And I turned around, and when I laid hands on Bishop T.D. Jakes, the grace of God, of course, fell. 30 days later, his secretary called and said, Bishop said to tell Brother Mike that one of the football players of the Dallas Cowboys had just planted his first $1 million seed. This is the jealous section right through here. I'm looking for the happy people here. The anointing I respect. How do you receive an anointing? Different types of anointing. Different, because a man's anointing, my experience with God, determines my message to men. Brother Oral Roberts had tuberculosis. God healed him. That's his message to men. I was born in poverty, where my father couldn't even put me through Bible school for $4 a day. So that became my experience with God. There's people this week, the Holy Spirit will nudge you. How do you say 17,000? I'm afraid to try to say cities because they'll laugh at me. I can feel it.
17,000 cities.
Say it with passion.
17,000 cities.
There are several this week that you'll feel something in your spirit and say, God, that's me. I want your blessing on my future. Give me supernatural wisdom in my job. Cause favor to come toward me. I want to tell you one little miracle. It's so small, I hesitate to say it. But somebody needs to hear it. Everything multiplies, including nothing. A seed of nothing creates a season of nothing. That's why the poorest of the poor were instructed to sow a turtle dove, a pigeon, sheep, some meal. Anything God touches multiplies. If I sow nothing, I create a season of nothing. Everything I put in God's hand multiplies, including nothing. I just started off in the ministry. I was saving my money, and after several months, I had $200 saved for clothes, and I was so excited. $200. Kept it in my wallet. Went to hear a preacher like this in a meeting, and the Holy Spirit says, give him the $200 in your pocket. I explained to the Holy Spirit that I was going to be buying some clothes. Then he said again, plant those two $100 seeds in his ministry. Is it still available? Thanks. One week later, phone rings at 12 o'clock midnight. A woman says, is this Mike Murdock? I said, yes, ma'am. She said, the young evangelist? I said, yes, ma'am. She said, you don't know me. My husband and I were in your meeting a year ago outside of Memphis, Tennessee, in West Memphis, Arkansas. My son died 4 weeks ago. Tonight, God told me and my husband to buy you some clothes. Are you coming through Memphis, Tennessee anytime soon? Or what do you think? Of course I'm going through Memphis, Tennessee. I may have to go through Baghdad, but I'll get to Memphis. Got off the plane. They bought me 4 suits at the nicest men's store. 6 months later, they bought me 4 more. 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 Then a man named Bob Rogers, he pastors in Louisville, Kentucky. You may know Bob. He's a great man of God, known for his prayer teaching. He leans over on Sunday night and says, "What you doing tomorrow?" I said, "What would you like to do?" He said, "God told me to buy you some clothes." Another evangelist called me to her house. She's Nancy Harmon, lady evangelist that travels everywhere. She said, "Come to my house." I went in. There's clothes everywhere. I said, "Nancy, what's all these clothes?" She said, "God told me to buy you some clothes." I'm in New York. Dewey Friedel is the pastor. He's the chaplain of the New York Yankees baseball team. And he leans over and he says, "What are you doing tomorrow?" I said, "What would you like to do?" He said, "God told me to buy you some clothes." The next morning, he's in the nicest store in New York, and he's picking out clothes, $2,000 suits. And in walks Dr. Rob Thompson from Chicago. He said, "You buying Mike some clothes?" He said, "Yes." He said, "I might as well buy him some too." I go to Hong Kong, and I'm at a store called Sammy Taylor, customized suits and shirts, and I pile them high. And just as I get ready to pay for them, in walks Dr. Dave Sumrall, friend of mine who pastors in Manila, Philippines. You may know Dave Sumrall. He's a nephew to Dr. Lester Sumrall. He walks in with Rob Thompson, and they said, "You're buying clothes?" I said, "Yes." They pulled out their credit card and said, "We won't let you buy any clothes." For over 44 years, all over the world, people buy me clothes. I've got $2,000 suits in my closet, Bishop, with the price tag still on them. Thank y'all. Thank you. The rest of you can stay home tomorrow night. This will be the people we want to talk to. Joke. Say, "I'm not jealous, Mike." Say it again. I've been stunned. I received a very simple instruction. Take your clothes money and bring it to God, wrapped with expectation. Hallelujah. So when I tell you tonight that tonight's the poorest you will ever be the rest of your life, get excited. We have a Jehovah Jireh in our land. We have a Jehovah Jireh in our life. God gave me a wisdom key. Are we on streaming live? People watching by live? Right there at your house, right here on this website, there's an opportunity to wrap expectation around your seed. Expectation. What's $200 in CDs? CDs.
400.
400 CDs. CDs. Huh? 2 to 1, yes. I don't know what's going to happen out of the 400, but I want you to wrap expectation around it. Talk to your seed. Give your seed an assignment. Where do you want to see the harvest? An uninstructed seed is not authorized to multiply. Every seed requires a divine conversation. I want you to hold that in your hand in a moment. I want you to hold it up to God, wrapped with expectation. There's a woman came up to me in America, and she said, my husband left me 15 years ago, and he's never given me $1 to raise my children, child support. I said, did you put his name on your seed? She said, yes. I said, then watch what God will do. 2 weeks later, she got her first check from him for $65,000. A seed given an instruction. It may not be big to some of us, 400 CDs. I'll learn how to say that. But it's big to God. It's obedience. God has kept me in clothes for over 40 years from a one-time seed. Say I'm a receiver. Say I choose to be a receiver. We receive this instruction. We receive this opportunity from God. In the next 48 hours, I will share with you some incredible secrets of receiving from God. Almost no one has what everything God wanted you to have. Almost none of us have learned how to receive. We don't know how to receive difference in other people. We don't know how to receive an opportunity. We don't know how to receive a compliment. We don't know how to receive an instruction. So tonight, we ask God, make me a world-class receiver. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. In Brazil, 4 weeks ago, God said, talk to this preacher and tell him he's got to learn to be a receiver. So I knelt down beside him in a chair, and I said, Pastor, I don't know you, but God told me you did not know how to receive. And I'm going to pray that God make you a receiver. And he starts talking to me, Pastor. He said, a man gave me a car one time. And I looked at the man and said, this car is mine. I can do anything I want to with it. The man said, yes, sir. He said, okay, I'm going to give this car you gave to me. I'm going to give it to the church. And I said, why were you so dishonoring? Why did you treat that man that way? He didn't give his car to the church. He gave it to you. Why didn't you learn how to receive it? Why didn't you learn how to show honor? Why did you give it to the church? You took this man's gift to you. I said, what if you gave me 400 CDs? What if you gave that to me and said, Dr. Mike, this is for you? And I said, oh, thanks. Hey, I don't need it. I got plenty here. You have it. You take it. What an insult. What an insult. Do you know how to receive? And I knelt down beside him and I laid hands on him. I said, God, this man doesn't know how to receive. He doesn't know how to receive your blessing. Teach him. And the next time somebody comes to him, let him know how to be thankful. Let him know how to pray for that person. Pastor, there'll be people during this week come to you with large seeds. And they'll say, Pastor, this is to buy your wife something. Don't tell them she has enough. I'm going to put this in the children's church. Well, you didn't get where you are not knowing how to receive. We receive with grace. I just got a mail from them. Somebody just given him over $100,000 within 14 days from that prayer. He's learned how to receive. Somebody else is paying for half of his church. He's learning to receive. Say, God, teach me how to receive. Oh, say it with passion. Lord, teach me how to receive. Say it again. Teach me how to receive. I want you to hold your Bible on your lap. Just hold your Bible there. If you've got a wallet, hold your wallet. I want my pastor to stand with me. Would you come stand with me? I want everyone across this room who would like to master the art of receiving. Listen carefully. Did you know Oral Roberts personally? I had the wonderful privilege of being very strong involved with his life. He called me one day. I was sitting on a bed in a hotel in Alabama. He said, Mike, write these words down. Your miracle is coming towards you, are going past you every day. And if you don't see it, you lose it. I said, say that again. He said, your miracle is coming towards you, are going past you every day. And if you don't see it, you lose it. I said, Dr. Roberts, that's not a singable kind of song. I said, I was 36 at the time. I said, is that really important, those words? I was dumb. He said, let me put it this way. If you and Richard were standing beside my bed and I was going to die in 5 minutes, the last sentence in my mouth would be, your miracle is coming towards you, are going past you every day. And if you don't see it, you lose it. I said, have you lost miracles? He said, thousands of miracles. I said, if you've lost thousands of miracles, Oral Roberts, I've lost millions. I said, let me think about this. He said, no, we're right here making television programs here in the studio here at Tulsa. And I don't want to make another program until you write this song. I want you to write it right now. I said, Dr. Roberts, I don't even have a piano here. And his wife, Evelyn, spoke up, said, Mike, we're all here waiting for you. You can do it. I sat in that bed without a piano, and I wrote those words. Your miracle is coming towards you. It's coming towards you, are going past you every day. It became a theme song to their ministry. This came up in my spirit a few moments ago. I've asked God to raise up 300 millionaires under our teaching for the sake of the gospel. We have 38 so far. Wouldn't it be glorious if the rest of the 300 came out of this week? That God would raise up the rest of the 300. Say, I'm a receiver. Say it again, I'm a receiver. Say it again, I'm a receiver. I want every man to stand to your feet. Every man. Some of you are looking around like you're not sure. So you can ask somebody, do I look like a man? Men, we've received from God the responsibility for our household. The scriptural purpose of a wife is to be a wealth manager. I'll explain that Wednesday night. That's the calling of a woman, to manage the wealth a man brings home. Rebecca was a wealth manager. The Proverbs 31 woman was a wealth manager. God's brought you a woman. She's God's greatest gift to you. I don't care what anybody else told you. She's God's greatest gift to you. Receive her as the queen of your house. Receive her as the prophetess in your bosom. Receive her as a gift from the Holy Spirit. Receive your children as gifts from God. Receive your boss. Receive the people that's given you opportunity. Receive your parents as gifts from God. Everything that's missing in your life is something you have not received. If I could teach you how to receive, I could change your life radically in 30 days. Your world would change if you knew how to respond to favor, how to respond to the gift of access. You know Dr. Mar Cirillo? You know Brother Cirillo? Some time ago, he'd been begging me to stay at the house with me and Mama. He's 83 right now, I think it is, 83. And I couldn't. I had things to do. And I said, Dr. Cirillo, I've got so many things to do back home, I cannot. And I suddenly remembered this message. I was receiving an opportunity to spend the night in the home of a true man of God. I may have had many things to do, but I needed to learn how to receive. How to receive. Do you know how to receive the gift of access? What's left your life because you didn't know how to receive it? Anything dishonored exits. Anything you honor stays. Everything you've lost in your life has been something you did not know how to receive. I receive the blood covering my sins. I receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Why don't you wave a hand and just say, Lord, I receive. Men, pray this prayer with me. Precious Holy Spirit, I receive the responsibility of being the leader in my home. Destiny will take place. My family will see your glory. Take my hands and make them prosper. Give me divine wisdom for my responsibilities. I receive my family as gifts from you. I receive instructions as opportunities to show honor. Today I am a receiver. Make me a world-class receiver. I am willing to be healed. I'm willing to be changed. I'm willing to become a learner. I'm willing to embrace mentorship. Now lift both hands high, and in your own words, thank him for every gift he has given you. Praise him aloud. Don't mumble in your beard. Praise him aloud. Father, I receive. I receive. I'm a receiver. I receive my gifts. I receive my assignment. I receive my difference. I am a receiver of my divine difference. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. In the name of Jesus. I want every lady to join us men standing. Every lady, join us as we're standing. Every lady in this house, what a joy to see so many men in this place. What a joy. I want every lady to stand. Lift both hands, ladies. Lift both hands high to God. Say these words, precious Holy Spirit, I receive your assignment for my life. I will be a woman of integrity. I'll be a woman of truth. No lie will come out of my mouth. I'm a worshiper. I will be a woman of wisdom in my home. My house shall be a house of peace. Teach me to manage the wealth that you're bringing into my life. I will prosper. I will prosper. I will prosper. My house will be a house of prayer. My house will be a place of learning. I will master the art of learning, and I will master receiving. Now, everybody, take somebody's hand right next to you. Take someone's hand next to you. Pastor, I've gone extra time tonight. But in the hotel room, and by the way, thank you for such world-class accommodations. I felt like telling your men when I saw my beautiful suite at the hotel, God's leading me to stay in Ghana for a year. So gorgeous, thank you. And your men could not treat me better. They could not treat us better. Did you have the same kind of graciousness? Oh, they treated you better, okay. I want you to pray with me. This 400 CDs, is that right, CDs? Is small compared to the harvest. It's big for some of us. It's big. God didn't tell me at that time what you're willing to walk away from determines what I'll bring to you. But that's what he taught me through that. I took my clothes money. It took me months. It took me months to save that much money in my first year of evangelism. Second year, I had no money. Very poor. But when God talks to you about a seed, he's got a harvest on his mind. Bishop, this seed of 400 CDs is not to buy carpet for the house of the Lord. This is to place in your hands. And it's actually a little seed of gratitude for your ministry, for your anointing. This 400 is not big to most of us. But this is not for paying the lights. This is for you and your wife. I want you to come and stand beside him, would you? This seed is for their anointing. Now, it may take you years to learn it. I know this is a small seed. Many of us would love to give them the 17,000, and God will deal with you about that. And do it. Do it as God leads. The greatest financial seed that I ever sowed was in Oral Roberts, the man over my life, just like you are a spiritual father to so many of us. We sow down for health. Isaiah 58, Psalms 41. I don't give to the poor for money. I give to the poor for my health. The Bible said my health will spring forth speedily if I reach out to the afflicted soul. What I give to the poor is a different seed for a different harvest. Ezekiel 40 says, if I sow up, the oil will flow down. You familiar with that scripture? And the peace will remain in our household. Hallelujah. The anointing I sow into is the anointing that comes upon me. How many, every time God blesses our brother and sister, the same thing will happen for us. How many would love that? How many wish every time God gave me a jet, he would give you one? You don't like jets, do you? I'm looking, who? You like jets? Okay, let me, yeah. Some people pray for cars, but I feel more faith for jets. The anointing we respect is the anointing that multiplies on our life. We're going to come. I'd like for your ushers to come and stand beside you. Pastor, you've shown me honor. I decree that everything God does for me, he does for you. Every time God gives me a miracle, he gives you one. When God gives me a car, he gives you a car. When God opens doors for me, he opens the same doors for you. I come into a covenant as you walk beside the man of God, as you're the queen of this place, the queen of this ministry, I decree that from the north, the south, the east, and the west, that everything God does for me, he will do for you. Everything God gives to me, he gives to you. When he gives me a jet, he gives you a jet. When he gives me clothes, he gives you clothes. Because the anointing we respect is the anointing that grows upon us. As you hold somebody's hand, pray this prayer and squeeze their hand two or three times to say, I'm in covenant with you. Say it again, I'm in covenant. I'm in covenant. I am in covenant. Some of us have it tonight. It's not. We don't have to wait till tomorrow night. Some of us don't have to wait till Sunday. We have this 400 with us tonight. And when I release you to come, I never negotiate with God, because when he talks to me about a seed, he's got a harvest on his mind. How many's got a dream a lot bigger than 400 CDs? How many's dream is a lot bigger than that? Wave a hand to God. Pray this prayer with me. In the name of Jesus, I wrap my faith around this uncommon seed. Father, you did it for Mike Murdock. You have blessed him for over 40 years with blessing. Let the same anointing come upon my household. Receive this tonight. As I receive this instruction, I receive this opportunity, I receive this covenant. Let the blessing of the Lord come upon my life. Within 8 days, let the first harvest begin. Within 8 days, let the first harvest begin. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. I receive the hundredfold harvest. I receive the hundredfold harvest. In the name of Jesus, it is done. Now, we do not have the time for each of us to put our arms around them and tell them how much we love them. They'll know it by our seed. But I want, is there a special system you have for row number one or row number two? The ushers will conduct that, all right? Wave your right hand high to God and say, I will brag like Mike Murdock the rest of my life about the goodness of God. Oh, wave a hand, say, I will brag like Mike Murdock as God blesses me. I want every person in this room that has your 400 CDs tonight, you have it tonight, you have it tonight. You can bring it tomorrow night, you can bring it the next night, but many of us have it tonight. I want you to quickly leave your seat and come place it in this. And as you place it, say, I'm a receiver of the hundredfold. I am a receiver of the hundredfold. I am a receiver of the hundredfold. I am a receiver of the hundredfold. Quickly, all across this room, I am a receiver of the hundredfold. I am a receiver of the hundredfold. I am a receiver of the hundredfold. As you tap it, just tap this offering bucket. You just receive it. Say, Lord, I'm a receiver. You can place any of them. I'm a receiver of the hundredfold. Those who need the harvest the most ought to be up here first. Those who need the harvest the most. Do you know that song, God is so good? God, you're so good. You know that song? God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You are so good to me. God, you're so good. Everybody. God, you're so good. Oh, God, you're so good. You are so good to me. There's some here tonight sowing the 400, and it's big. It's big to you. You're trying to make a car note. You're trying to pay for your children to go to school. So God sees it. God sees this seed. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. Father, we sanctify this seed as holy. We invest it in the anointing of a proven man of God. It's gone around the world and brought the gospel to so many. Quickly come to the balcony. We'll wait for you. In the balcony and the overflow areas, we'll wait for you. Oh, God. Somebody needs to be up here quickly. You need the harvest a lot more than you need the 400. You can't do very much with 400, but you can do a lot with the hundredfold return. We believe in the harvest. We believe in the harvest. Oh, we believe in the harvest. 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 Come, come. Never negotiate with a giver. Never negotiate with a giver. Never negotiate with the Holy Spirit. Quickly come. Quickly come.
Years before God gives you this kind of